blue cover hast thou hid, my beloved Lord? O'er a blue sky, under blue cover hast thou hid, my beloved Lord? Open thy cover, let me discover. Open thy cover, let me discover, my beloved Lord, in thy hearts of hearts, my beloved Lord, in thy hearts of hearts. Open thy cover, let me discover. Open thy cover, let me discover, my beloved Lord, in thy hearts of hearts, my beloved Lord, in thy hearts of hearts.
The voice of God calls us to awaken him. How will he find us when he comes?
Awake and ready!
And when he asks us to dedicate our lives ever more perfectly to him, how will he find us?
Awake and ready!
Let's pray together. Divine Mother.
Divine Mother.
Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Friend, beloved God.
Friend, beloved God.
Great Masters.
Great Masters.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Babaji Krishna.
Babaji Krishna.
Lahiri Mahashaya.
Lahiri Mahashaya.
Swami Sri Yukteswar.
Swami Sri Yukteswar.
Beloved Guru.
Beloved Guru.
Paramahansa Yogananda.
Paramahansa Yogananda.
Saints of all religions.
Saints of all religions.
We humbly bow to you all.
We humbly bow to you all.
Divine Mother.
Divine Mother.
Open our hearts.
Open our hearts.
Purify us.
Purify us.
Free us.
Free us.
Give us thyself.
Give us thyself.
That we may give thee to all.
That we may give thee to all.
We are your children.
We are your children.
Flood us with your love.
Flood us with your love.
That we may share it with all.
That we may share it with all.
Om.
Peace.
Amen.
Amen.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed who thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, they shall be called the children of God. Blessed those reviled for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Meditate as we listen to these words from Affirmations for Self-Healing on contentment. Contentment has been said to be the supreme virtue. Contentment means living to the fullest the good of every passing moment. Above all, it means living behind the present moment, in the eternal now. How much is lost in life by people who perennially wish things other than they are, who complain unceasingly, and tell themselves that the world owes them more than it is giving them. We must smile inwardly with God, knowing that life is His dream. Contentment is the surest way of drawing the very best out of every circumstance. Let's affirm together, first in a strong voice, then a normal speaking voice, then a whisper, then silently. Through life's mightiest storms,
through life's mightiest storms,
I am contented.
I am contented.
For I hold in my heart,
for I hold in my heart,
God's peace.
God's peace.
Through life's mightiest storms,
through life's mightiest storms,
I am contented.
I am contented.
For I hold in my heart,
for I hold in my heart,
God's peace.
God's peace.
Now in a whisper. Through life's mightiest storms,
through life's mightiest storms,
I am contented.
I am contented.
For I hold in my heart,
God's peace.
Now lifting the affirmation to the superconscious mind at the point between the eyebrows, and silently affirming, through life's mightiest storms, I am contented, for I hold in my heart God's peace. Through life's mightiest storms, I am contented, for I hold in my heart God's peace. And pray silently with me. Lord, as you live eternally at rest in yourself, so let me live also, contented ever, that I may be worthy of living in your joy. Om.
Peace.
Good morning, friends.
Good morning. Morning.
Good morning.
You know her, but if not, Narayan. It's my wife, Dharmadevi. Welcome to old friends, new friends, friends joining us online. And every week we share from Rays of the One Light. These are weekly commentaries in the Bible and the Bhagavad Gita. And this week is on the topic of, can man see God? Truth is one and eternal. Realize oneness with it in your deathless self within. The following commentary is based on the teachings of Paramahansa Yogananda. There is a saying in chapter 1 of the Gospel of St. John that would seem to respond with a definite no to the question, can man see God? The saying is, no man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. Many saints, however, claim to have seen God. If we ask then, can God be seen, rather than can man see God, the answer is yes, else those saints lied, and the scriptures themselves lied. For Jesus also said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. The point is, it is not man, this human body, these human eyes, that sees God. God can be seen only with spiritual vision, with the eye of the soul. As the Bhagavad Gita puts it in the 11th chapter, thou canst not see me with mortal eyes. Therefore now I give thee sight divine. Behold my supreme power of yoga. With these words, Hari, the exalted Lord of Yoga, revealed himself to Arjuna in his infinite form. Paramahansa Yogananda, in Autobiography of a Yogi, describes the supernal experience in words more readily comprehensible to modern minds than the poetic phraseology of the Bhagavad Gita. The chapter, An Experience in Cosmic Consciousness, is one of the most inspiringly beautiful in all mystical literature. Here's a brief excerpt. An oceanic joy broke upon calm, endless shores of my soul. The spirit of God, I realized, is exhaustless bliss. His body is countless tissues of light. I saw the divine dispersion of rays pour from an eternal source, blazing into galaxies, transfigured with ineffable auras. Again and again, I saw the creative beams condense into constellations, then resolve into sheets of transparent flame. By rhythmic reversion, sextillion worlds passed into diaphanous luster. Fire became firmament. I cognized the center of the Empyrean as a point of intuitive perception in my heart. Irradiating splendor issued from my nucleus to every part of the universal structure. The creative voice of God I heard resounding as Om, the vibration of the cosmic odor. This, so the great masters aver, is what God is. And this also, they insist, is what we are in our deepest reality. Thus, through Holy Scripture, God has spoken to mankind.
Roses and daisies, the shining veils of clouds of burning gold, the dark star-decked shawl of the night. But how long wilt thou remain hidden behind all these veils? I love them because they hint at thy presence, yet still they hide thee. I long to see thee as thou art behind all this cover of veils. So this topic, can man see God? I have to admit, the first thing that popped in my mind, anyone Lord of the Rings fans? Well, if you remember, there's a tricky part in the story. Some of you are smiling, so I know you know what I mean. But one of the most terrible characters, evil guy, really bad and really powerful. He has this boon, and I will give it away because otherwise it won't make sense. But we get to the battlefield, and this great warrior steps up to fight him, and he says, "Don't you know, I have the boon. No man can kill me." And the long flowing hair of the handmaiden, and she says, "I am no man," and whacks off his head. But unfortunately, can man see God? The trick is not can woman see God. Woman can see God, no. Man in this case represents all of us, human beings. But I want to pick this up from a slightly different thread, from can man see God to how can we see God? Because Swami explained very clearly this dual nature of the world, that when we're in our earthly matter-conscious selves, We can't see God. We can't get a glimmer of that divine nature that Yogananda so beautifully described. We're doing a meditation teacher training, And this man just shared with us yesterday about an experience that he had. The week before, he had left the class, and he was feeling really uplifted from the community of great souls that are here. And he said, you know, he was just kind of on cloud nine, and he went for a jog, and he did his, I guess it sounded like a normal loop that he's done many times, and he got in his car and he was ready to leave, and he saw sitting on this bench Yogananda. And he said, I don't want to say I saw Yogananda, but this guy looked exactly like Yogananda. There was no, I don't know how it could be anyone other than Yogananda. And he was wearing a Notre Dame sweatshirt. And he giggled. But you could tell he was so deeply touched. And he said, Notre Dame has a special meaning for my family. And so God doesn't even just appear to us in that divine state. He appears to us perfectly as we can relate to him on the most beautiful level. There's an interesting story. I got drawn into the Genesis story from the Bible, and Yogananda wrote extensively about Genesis. And I wanted to touch on it a little bit because it's very important. We get a lot of questions of why did God do this to us? It's a fair question. We're in a bit of a pickle. We have these veils and veils of illusion, like I read in the Whispers. And we can look at it and say, why? Why all these veils of delusions, of delusion? Or like Narayan likes to say, we can say, we're in this pickle. Now how do we get out? How do we get out of this pickle? But the Genesis story beautifully describes, well, once you have Yogananda's commentary on it, that God didn't mean for this pickle to happen. He created us as divine beings. And it's really beautiful. I want to read to you just a bit. God created the human species. This is Yogananda's words on Genesis. God created the human species by materializing the bodies of man and woman through the force of his will. He endowed the new species with the power to create children in a similar, immaculate, or divine manner. Because his manifestation in the individualized soul had hitherto been limited to animals, instinct-bound and lacking the potentialities of full reason, God made the first human bodies, symbolically called Adam and Eve. To these, for advantageous upward evolution, he transferred the souls or divine essence of two animals. In Adam, or man, reason predominated. In Eve, or woman, feeling was ascendant. Thus was expressed the duality or polarity which underlies the phenomenal worlds. Reason and feeling remain in a heaven of cooperative joy so long as the human mind is not tricked by the serpentine energy of animal propensities. Interesting, he touches on evolution, but not in the sense of a Darwinian evolution that we were monkeys at some point. Maybe we were monkeys in past lives. But not the human being did not evolve from a chimp. And he says, he calls it the myth of evolution. And he says, where are the half man, half chimps? It's a myth because God specially made the human being with a divine potential. If you've ever heard Dr. Peter Van Houten from Ananda speak. He does such a beautiful job talking about the brain being engineered for divinity. That's such a lovely way to put it, because it is. And we have also this energy of the coiled serpent that lies dormant at the base of the spine. And that's the Kundalini. And when that energy awakens, which is part of our divine trek back to our infinite source, it awakens also this subconscious tendency in us that goes, ooh, I feel a little instinct of something, whatever it may be. Ooh, my energy wants to go outward. Ooh, this is neat, this is beautiful, this is fun. And our senses get awakened along with that. And rather than going, oh, I remember, this is God's play, this is creation that God made for us, not to get locked and trapped and into in such a way that we forget our divine reality, but in such a way that we go, oh, there's so much more. There's so much more in God. And we take that energy, and instead of just pouring it out through the senses continually, we go, oh, but God is so much greater. That divine bliss of my soul is so much better. Yogananda would talk about the divine man and woman that God created, and it's a story. But he said, he sat them down there. Okay, here's creation, guys. And they sat in lotus posture and boop, returned back to their infinite source in God. And he said, no, have fun. This is creation. I made it for you. Look, isn't it great? And they, okay. And sat back in lotus posture, boop, and merged back into God. And so he created this veil of separateness, so they didn't just see God all the time. And it was, wow, there's beautiful things here. And God's, oh, good, they're doing what I asked them to do, they're enjoying creation. Look, they're in bliss, they're harmonious with each other. And then they forgot about God. And they started to enjoy without the joy of God. And these veils got thicker and thicker. So when we ask ourselves, why would God do this? Well, God didn't have the intention for us to be so so clouded by delusion that we would forget him. And all we have to do is remember him. And those clouds begin to part. Some of the veils are so thick, we need like laser vision to chop through them. We need to take out our sword of devotion and sever the heartstrings that have kept us bound to delusion. So in this Genesis story, Yogananda is very clearly talking about the heart and the point between the eyebrows. And he described these as the most important of our chakra, our energy centers to focus on for our spiritual evolution. And as he said, the feeling nature is predominant in women. The reason, which he said is centered at the point between the eyebrows, is predominant in men. And the idea is we have both masculine and feminine within us. We have reason and feeling, that sometimes it's hard to see one or the other in ourselves at times. But we have both qualities, and we can harmonize our nature. And it's our responsibility to do so. God gave us free will, which is why we've gotten into this pickle and gotten so deeply into this pickle. But now we can use our free will to to do the work that we need to do. And I wanted to especially offer two focuses, one for the spiritual eye and one for the heart. And these are, if you think of that song that Keshava sang so beautifully, Blessed Are They, and it's the Beatitudes, if you recognized it, that Jesus's talk on the Mount of Olives? Mount of, yeah, I don't have. Anyways, he gave this beautiful talk and stirred thousands of people. But blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So we have to purify the heart. And we can think of purifying the heart through gaining devotion, developing devotion. Yogananda said to Swami Kriyananda, get devotion, get devotion. He said it to many of the disciples. Look at how dry your life was before you got devotion. How can we get devotion? Ma Durga, another direct disciple of Yogananda's, there's a beautiful audio and booklet that SRF put out with her chants and some of her, just little clips of her speaking to other disciples. And it's really sweet. She would say, that peace that you feel, she had a fun accent, that peace that you feel in meditation, that is God. Hold on to that peace. And the same with all of the eight aspects of God that Yogananda gave, that peace, that love that we feel that's beyond. We can always tell when it's an aspect of God because there isn't a dual nature to it. If it's a piece of, oh, I just got home from work and I finally get a moment's peace, we know that that is gonna have its opposite of, well, I gotta go back to work. Or that love that we feel that's conditioned, that, well, I'll be your friend if you do what I like for you to do as a friend. And we know that that'll be met with the same kind of friendship that's not a true friendship. But when we feel a love that comes from within, or a joy that comes from within, and there's no, well, I know this is going to end bad again, just like everything else in this world, it has its up and its down. This, it has no down. It's just, it's God. It's infinite spirit. And so whether you have a relationship with God in a personal sense or not, we can all love those pure qualities of God. And that is God. That is God in the truest sense. So try to cultivate that in everyday life. When you feel something come up, don't immediately express it outwardly. Maybe you're with your loved one and you feel, gosh, I feel such a deep love for this person. Don't let it spill. Oh, I love you, honey. No, hold on to it for a moment and feel and say, God, I know this person is reminding me of my deeper love for you. And offer that love first to God and see what happens. It's amazing. It doesn't dissipate. It expands, and suddenly you have tapped into this infinite source of love, and you can then offer that love to everyone and to your loved one that's there with you. So purify the heart. That's getting devotion. Get more devotion. And the other aspect of it is the technique. And Yogananda offered so many techniques for us. And These are to help clarify the mind, to be able to focus so we can see these beautiful qualities of God, but if we're not able to focus on them, then it's just like a puff of smoke. There it is, oh, divine love, oh, it's so great, and oh, come back. No, because we're not focused on it enough. Our concentration is not strong enough yet. Our willpower is not strong enough yet. But the more we practice the techniques, the more we develop concentration, that focus. And that's the sixth limb of Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga, of dharana, of that one-pointed concentration on God or one of his aspects or one of her aspects. So when we have that deepened concentration and that deepened devotion, that's what Yogananda said, that Kriya Yoga, you can think of as the techniques, plus devotion works like mathematics. It cannot fail in bringing us back to God, into that oneness that we're all seeking.
Who is Sylvia? What is she? Let all our swains command her. Holy, fair, and wise is she. The heaven such grace did lend her, that she might admire it be, that she might admire it be. Is she kind as she is fair? For beauty lives with kindness. To her eyes loved doth repair, to help them of his blindness. And being helped inhabits them, and being helped inhabits them. Then to Sylvia let us sing, that Sylvia is excelling. She excels each mortal thing. Upon the dull earth dwelling, to her let us garlands bring, to her let us garlands bring.